I muted all.
ओके ओके थैंक यू ओके
ओके एंड रिकॉर्डिंग स्टार्ट.
या ओके हेलो
हेलो.
या माय वॉइस इज ऑडिबल ना?
यस सर.
या ओके सो बेसिकली दीज स्नेक्स दे आर वेरी शाय स्नेक्स एंड हाइड अवे फ्रॉम द स्ट्रेंजर्स विल बाइट ओनली व्हेन डिस्टर्ब्ड. So how can we correlate this this aspect of behavior of Senkris with the remedy Senkris or with the patient of Senkris? So basically here the rubrics that we can see are anger, interruption from, and disturbed, averse to being. So basically these patients, they get angry only when they are interrupted or disturbed. Otherwise, they are quite lethargic and still. Okay, so with like most viperids, they avoid humans and will leave the area without biting. There is another mechanism that they do, that is freezing mechanism. They often freeze instead of slithering away. So many bites occur due to people unknowingly stepping on or near them. So what they will do, they will not go away when approached. They will just lie still. They will freeze. So accidentally, people step onto them and then the bites may occur. They have a very good camouflage mechanism. This is basically to avoid predators, and humans are one of the predators. So they lie still on dead leaves or red clay, almost impossible to notice. Stay still even when approached closely. The defensive tail vibration behavior is seen when closely approached. Like you had seen in other rattlesnakes, they have a rattle on their tail and which they vibrate whenever an enemy approaches them. So these snakes, Senkris, it does not have a rattle, but it still vibrates its tail, which is a warning to the predators or enemies. And they strike only if sufficiently threatened. So even if you threaten them to an extent as to disturb them or interrupt them, only then will they strike. So just have a look at this picture. This is the way Senkris camouflages itself. If you look at the picture superficially, in the first glimpse, you will not be able to see the snake. You will just see the leaves and the dead leaves and the fallen leaves. If you look at it closely, only then will you be able to find the snake. So this is the way they camouflage themselves to avoid the predators. So they basically rely on olfaction for mate searching and prey and predator detection. The forked tongue collects chemical signals that are detected through the chemoreceptors on the tongue. So this is the way they search for their mates or they search for their prey and predators. Besides that, they have heat sensitive facial pits, which we had seen earlier. So by these pits, they locate the position of primarily endothermic prey. So these pits, they allow estimation of the direction from which the source of heat originates. And that is how they can detect a prey or a predator. Activity. So nocturnal during the hot summer, commonly active during the day in spring and fall. So in summers at night and spring and fall during daytime. They feed on small rodents large insects, frogs, cicadas. They are ambush predators, that is, they hide and wait for suitable prey. But in certain cases where they have to hunt for insects, there is an active hunting which is seen, that they will actively pursue the insects. Otherwise, they generally hide and wait for the prey to come. There is a behavior called as caudal luring observed in the juvenile snakes. So basically, they have brightly colored tail, which is the color of yellow sulfur, to attract frogs and lizards. We had seen yesterday also in Toxicophis. So this is the caudal luring behavior. If you can see at the tip of the tail, there is, it looks yellow, attractive, bright yellow in color. So they basically wiggle this tail, which looks like a caterpillar or some worms, by which the frogs or other smaller reptiles are attracted, and then they strike them and prey on them. So they are viviparous and give birth to live young ones. Breeding is in late summer, but not every year. Sometimes females produce young ones for several years running, then do not breed at all for a time. So for certain months, they will produce young ones, and then there is a long gap where they don't breed at all. Now, another process of reproduction which is seen here is facultative parthenogenesis. So they can also reproduce by this process, that is, they are capable of switching from a sexual mode of reproduction to an asexual mode of reproduction. So that is a different reproductive phenomena observed in them, that they can also produce asexually. Now the bites. So the bites are venomous, but generally not aggressive unless disturbed. So that we had already seen, that they are not very aggressive unless you threaten them or disturb them. Bites are rarely fatal except in children and very old people. So the death is not recorded unless very small children or very old people with certain conditions and who are very weak. Now, warning bite. So when stepped on or agitated, inject a relatively small amount of venom. Like I told you, they are not very aggressive. So when you step on them or you agitate them, it will just give you a warning bite, wherein it will inject a very small amount of venom, which is not really fatal. Then there are dry bites also, which involves no venom at all. So venom is basically a weak venom. It is least toxic among all pit vipers. The action is hemolytic, and the effects that it causes are hemorrhages and tissue lysis. So it's basically a hemolytic venom. It causes hemorrhages and tissue lysis. The mechanism through which it happens is intravascular coagulation, fibrinolysis, damage to vascular endothelium, and necrosis. So these are the events through which the hemorrhages and tissue lysis occurs. However, when compared with other snakes, there are not much hemorrhages here. Very, very mild hemorrhages will be seen. So now the bite symptoms. There is extreme pain, edema, hemorrhage, but the hemorrhage is very mild, not much. The damage can occur to muscle and bone tissue when bite occurs on outer extremities, such as the hands and feet, in which a large muscle is not available to absorb the venom. So then the damage may occur to muscle and bone. Otherwise, it generally doesn't cause that much of damage. Along with that, there is fever and lethargy and severe nausea. So this is a picture of a bite by Cenchrus chondrotrix or Ancestrodon chondrotrix. If you see, the other hand is swollen compared to the right hand, and you can also see a bluish, blackish kind of discoloration. Now, mild envenomation, where only a slight amount of venom is injected. So locally, there's extreme pain, tingling, throbbing, mild cellulitis. Systemic effects, there is nausea, headache, lethargy, respiratory distress. In moderate envenomation, there is vomiting, intestinal discomfort. So why it's important to remember some of these symptoms is because you can then correlate it with certain particulars of Cenchrus. Because in Cenchrus, we also find intestinal discomfort in Cenchrus as a remedy. We find intestinal symptoms. We also find respiratory symptoms. We find nausea, stomach symptoms. So that's why it's important to remember this. So there's vomiting, intestinal discomfort, sweating and fever, mild bleeding, ecchymosis, unconsciousness, stupor, sinus tachycardia, hypotension. Cenchrus as a remedy also has heart affections, if you see. Death is very rare, fatal only in children, old, weak people. Now, this is an experiment, an animal experiment, which was carried on in the mice. I would just like to inform you all about it. So the venom contains a protein called chondrostatin, found to halt growth of cancer cells in mice and to stop migration of the tumor to other sites. So basically, it was found when injected in the mice. These mice were also injected with human breast cancer cells, and it was found that after injecting the venom, the growth of the cancer cells was halted and even the metastasis was halted. However, this is an animal model and further testing is required to verify safety and efficacy in humans. So that was all about Cenchrus as a snake and about the venom toxicological effects. Now we will study Cenchrus as a remedy, as a homeopathic remedy. So far, I would like to ask you all if I was audible and if the screen is visible. Can anyone tell me? Or Arun sir, can you please tell me?
Yes, audible.
Okay, so I'll just proceed.
I can see screen.
Yeah.
Just I would want to ask to audience.
Yeah.
Is there any query?
No, sir. No, sir. Everything okay.
Okay.
So I'll go forward. Okay. Now, we'll come to Cenchrus as a remedy. We'll come to the Materia Medica part. So Cenchrus, it affects the system profoundly like other snakes. So even Cenchrus, it is a deep remedy. It affects the system profoundly. And it has many other symptoms. It has many symptoms of other snakes as well. However, it is also proven, but it is not very frequently used by many physicians. Hence, you can call it like a rare remedy because it is not really very well used. So now the majority of symptoms, they come up on the mental plane, respiratory tract, heart, and female reproductive system. So Kent has actually given the proving and written pages after pages of Cenchrus, but we will not go into details of everything. We will just look what is most important. Here, most important is respiratory system, heart affections, female reproductive system, intestinal system, and certain symptoms of the eye. And besides that, the mind. So we'll first study the mind of Senkris. So what I'll do here is, I will tell you about the proving symptoms, how the prover has expressed what Kent has written in his Materia Medica. Because somebody had in the previous presentation asked me how a patient will present. So if you go through the proving symptoms, how Kent has written, you will understand how a patient may present to you, because they have been recorded in patient's language. So we will see how the symptoms were expressed and recorded by the provers. And side by side, we will also see the rubrics, and we will also see certain themes which have come up. Okay, so in Kent's provings, the predominating symptoms that have come up on the mind were absent-mindedness, anxiety about death, and vivid lascivious dreams. So these were, if you study the whole proving, these were the predominating symptoms that Kent says, which were found in most provers, and which were very important and characteristic for this remedy. Okay, so absent-mindedness, anxiety about death, and vivid and lascivious dreams. So this you should definitely remember if you have to remember the mind of Senkris. So first, absent-mindedness. You will find Senkris in the rubric mind, absent-minded, dreamy. They go in a dreamy state. When you look at them, you will feel they are not actually present here. They go in another state. They go in their thoughts. And they are not present in the current situation or scenario. So that is absent-minded and dreamy. So this is what the prover had mentioned. Catch myself staring into space and forget what people are saying to me, or that there is anyone in the room. So she stares into space, forgets what people are telling her, and she forgets that there is anyone in the room. She goes into a totally different space. Inability to concentrate. So absent-minded and stupid that I tremble and shiver and my teeth chatter for some time before I begin to realize that I feel cold. So she is so absent-minded that she doesn't even realize she is feeling cold. Even though there is trembling of her body and teeth are chattering, she is not able to realize that she is actually feeling cold. So that is the state, an absent-minded state, a lack of concentration. She goes into another space, not realizing what is happening around her. So very dreamy, constantly dwelling into her dreams, into her thoughts. Only one minute is left now. So after the session gets over, kindly rejoin it. Okay. So there's a dreamy feeling. Her mind is all blank for 10 minutes, but people did not observe anything wrong with her appearance. So when you look at her, she seems fine, but her mind is totally blank. Others will not be able to see her confusion, her blankness. So this is an example that she gives. When riding in the car, she wrote by the place she intended to get off at. So she was riding in the car, but in her absent-mindedness, her dreamy state, she forgot where she had to get off. And she wrote off the place. उसको जहां उतरना है उससे आगे चली जाती है. Okay. Dreamy, absent-minded, took wrong car without